Welcome to Gardens in California. My name is Cheryl Turney, and I'll be your instructor and host, as I have been on all our previous programs. And if you haven't watched the show before, or not familiar with how the show is formatted, this is a live broadcast, and you're encouraged to call in with your questions about your garden or garden problems, plant material you'd like to grow. Our number is 1-800-339-1193. I'm a plant pathologist with the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, and I have a lot of land history and a lot of experience on the technical aspects of landscape maintenance, which means pest control, disease control, where to plant plants, how to fertilize, how to water, what plants are appropriate for Southern California. I have an undergraduate degree in botany and a PhD in pathology. I've worked at Southern California Gardens in the area, so I've done this for a long time. Familiar with a lot of the problems you may be experiencing in your garden, and maybe I can give you some tips and some advice and some direction on how to deal with the problem you're having in your garden. So call in and tell us your problem, or tell us your successes. Actually, everyone calls in with their problems. Maybe some of you would like to come in, call in and tell us about some of the successes you're having in your garden instead of problems the problem. But people don't do the problem when their gardens are doing well, they call in when their gardens are doing poorly. Now, we always start our show with upcoming events, so you can put these on your calendar and get out and enjoy the rainfall all together. The autumn air is coming up at Disposal Gardens in Lockingdown and Flintridge. That's October 16th and 17th. That'll be next weekend. Autumn air is free. An entrance to the gardens is always a paid entrance. And the phone number is 818-949-4200. Give them a call and or go on their website and you can read more about autumn air. Also, Disposal Gardens is their harvest festival and plant fair. And that's October 22nd through 24th from 9 to 4. And you can see the fees there for getting into the gardens. And their number is also there. So give them a call or check their website and see if you're in that area of Los Angeles County. And the annual pumpkin festival is coming up at Cal Poly Pomona, October 16th and 17th, and that'll be next week as well. From 8 to 5 p.m. This is a free event, and of course you can pick up pumpkins there, but they have a lot of events and a lot of things to do with trimmers. It's a great family event. And the number is 909-869-2215. If you're out in the eastern part of LA County, that'd be wonderful to do next weekend. And the Arboretum Adventures Sun Prints will be October 23rd. Saturday, October 23rd from 8 to 5 p.m. This is free with admission into the gardens, and their number is 626-821-3222. To give them a call or check their website for more information about sun plants. Also, they have the Arboretum Adventures Turtle Expedition, which will be on Saturday, November 6th, and that's all at the Arboretum Los Angeles County in Arcadia. And they have lots of events and programs there at the Arboretum. So check the website and see what you can go out and experience and have a good time. Let's see if we have any other events coming up. No, that's all for today's show. And yesterday I was at the Huntington Botanical Gardens for their fall plant sale, which is this weekend. Of course, there are a lot of cactuses and things. The Huntington is famous for their collection of cactus and succulents, and they propagate quite a few of them, and they always sell them in their plant sales, so you can find some real unusual plant materials at the Huntington. And if you're really a garden enthusiast, you want to grow some unusual stuff, not just the same old thing you see in all the big box stores, all those type of groceries. Then you go into the gardens like Descanso or the Huntington or the Arboretum or Fulton Arboretum or the San Diego Botanical Garden, Rancho San Juan out in Claremont. If you go to their plant sales, or if you get involved with those gardens, you'll find a lot of the more unusual plant materials, some things that will really make your garden distinct and different, and maybe more enjoyable for you. So, check their websites and get out and enjoy the day. Today's a beautiful day, nice warm day. Before we get into my main lecture, and today I will be lecturing on integrated pest management, I just want to mention that this is the prime time of the year to plant trees and shrubs. Get them in the ground in October or early November, and then they're going to be in the ground for about 9 months or so before you're going to get that heat next summer. So generally, plants do much better when planted at this time of the year. It's highly recommended, especially for natives, to give them a chance to get established before it gets really hot. It's not a good idea to plant them right at the beginning of the summer, when right before the heat. It's more difficult to keep them doing well during the hot spells. Rather, get some good root growth over the next 9 months, and then they'll do quite well. Now, for some of the things you might be interested in planting, you might want to wait until December if they come in as bare root plant materials. You can get bare root roses and bare root fruit trees, like stone fruits and apples and pears. So you might want to wait to plant those until December or January, where they're available as bare root nursery stock. Now, I wrote the hygiene yesterday, and there's so many great plants for sale, and I couldn't help myself. So one of my favorite plants are coleus. And if you're not familiar with coleus, let me show you some of some coleus cuttings I made this morning. After the burrow, I have a burrow coleus at home. I like coleus for a couple of reasons. I use it for color as opposed to flower color, because the foliage is colorful. And so it's one of the ways you can put color in your garden without using flowers. And flowers are always kind of brief and they don't last a long time. But you can see that the color in these coleus, they're really very colorful, and there's a wide variety of coleus that are very colorful. You see this one is really a dark purple, and this one is variegated, and with the red and green blotches. This one's really all green. These are typical, and then there's some other cuttings that are brown. Let's see these real quick. And the other thing about coleus is they're very easy to grow from seed. You can grow them outdoors for color. You can see that. This one has an interesting ruffled edge of the leaf. And this one is really quite striking with the red edge, or the burgundy edge, with a green, a lime green center. And then there's one more that I stuffed in here. That's it. You can see I just stuffed them in a cup of water. And if I want to root these, what I'll do is just cut off the bottom of these, like this. And wherever there's a node, you'll get root growth. And of course, these are root quite easily. These are one of the easiest plants to root. So you can cut off all those little stems, and then just put them in the water. And in about a week to 2 weeks, you'll have enough roots that you can move it to a pot, a small pot. And then maybe fill the pot, and then let it root, and fill that pot with roots. That'll take another 2 to 3 weeks, maybe 4 weeks. And then you can put it out in the garden. Now, there really is a spring and summer material. It's not a good idea to try and plant them into your garden at this time of year, because they are tender, they can freeze. Now, if you have been growing these, or similar herbaceous materials for color, not for flower color, but for foliage, for colorful foliage, like caladiums, or in this case, coleus. There's a lot of plants you can use for that type of color rather than growing for flowers. These will survive the winter if we don't have a hard freeze, and then in the spring, they'll get a little leggy. They tend to drop a lot of lower leaves, and you get a long stem with just a few leaves on the top, and refer to that as being leggy. And so, what you want to do is sometime around late February, after the danger of frost, you just pitch them back, give them a little fertilizer, and they come back up real strong. Things like in patience, they survive the winter if you're in an area where they don't get a hard freeze, especially along the coast, or in protected areas right up against your house if you're in one of the valleys. And it's harder to keep these herbaceous color alive during the winter, where we get a little colder, maybe up in Altadena or Sierra Madre, out on the riverside, where you get a little colder. If we get a good freeze, you'll lose them. But then they're easy to replant in the spring. And what I do, of course, is I grow colors mostly from seed. And then when the plants come up and I have a big bowl of them, and they're really quite beautiful right now, is I take these cuttings, I root them, and I get them growing in small pots, and then I just grow them in a greenhouse window over the winter, and in the spring I put them back out in the garden. So that's kind of a tip that you can do. Now, the reason I wanted to talk about coleus is because at the Huntington Institute, they had these King Kong varieties of coleus. And when I was bringing this one home, and you can see the leaf is as big as my hand. You can see how big that leaf is and how colorful it is. And this is the pot that it was growing in at the Huntington. And here's the Huntington Institute pot. And I'll just quickly maybe read off the tag that it says about these. And I haven't seen real coleus with such a huge leaf. Now, you see what happened here. It just broke right here when I was bringing it home. And normally I'd be a little upset that I damaged the plant that I just bought. But in this case, I didn't like this work this. So I stuck it in a little glass of water. It's nice and perfect still. It's got a lot of water still underneath. It hasn't wilted on me. I didn't pull off the bottom of these yet because I wanted to save it for the show. But this is Mosaic Concolius. And it's a perennial short-lived or annual 12 to 18 inches in height, shade or dappled shade, even. Some still have because girded well plant with bright light, pinch off flowers. Now, the other thing about colors, if you're not in bloom, the flowers are okay, they're not really spectacular, but they're not going to, but they will kind of diminish the growth of the leaf, since you're really using the growing colors as the bloom. So, anyway, that's colors. And this is the other one. I bought two of these farm varieties, so it's another one. This one, I just show you how spectacular they can be. Here are the two corn varieties. This one is a deep purple with kind of almost a blood red. You can see that. Let's see, there you go. It's really pretty. And those leaves are as big as your hand. So, really spectacular and a lot of color. And you don't have to worry about producing a flower or getting into leaf flower. They do, of course, produce flowers, but you pinch them off to encourage more leaf growth. So these are the corn varieties. I haven't seen seed of all before. And I just want to mention that there's lots of varieties of colors. And you can get a seed pack for a dollar or two, then quite easily grow from seed. I like to grow things from seed. I avoid some of the cell-borne diseases that you get from party packs that you purchase at the nursery. A lot of times when you go buy herbaceous plant materials at the nursery or buy things from a nursery, unfortunately, you can also bring home one of the cell-borne diseases. So if you grow seeds, you avoid that whole problem. And actually, when you grow seeds, you usually get better plants. So that's the colors. I just wanted to briefly mention that. And remind our viewers out there that this is a live podcast, and you can call in or email in your questions. Our phone number is 1-800-339-1193. Today I want to talk about integrated pest management and where that term came from and how you could apply some of those principles in your own garden and what the benefits of integrated pest management. Now, integrated pest management really started in reference to controlling insect pests in agriculture. Prior to the development of integrated pest management, especially after World War II, with the introduction of a lot of broad-spectrum insecticides that had lighting tools, and a lot of growers and farmers were just right on a calendar basis, and they wouldn't take into account whether the insect was really even there, or the population of the insect, or the fate of the chemicals they were using. They worked quite well in controlling the pest that they were trying to target. And they had, you didn't have to really worry about it. You just got spray, they were kind of cheap. But then we sort of had a lot of problems with that approach. First off, if you just indiscriminately use the same chemical over and over again, the insects would become resistant. A lot of the chemicals that were being used back in the 50s and early 60s had long residuals. They ended up drifting off of the farms or eroding off or ending up in waterways or groundwater. Or even showing up in animals. And so that's been a problem, and it's time had a new way to address how to use chemical controls to effectively control the pests, but at the same time reduce the amount of chemicals that you use. So the concept is integrated pest management, and what that means is to take any animal to you and evaluate it as to how you're going to control a specific pest in a specific crop. So it goes from the day you're planting your crop. If you're going to grow peach trees, if you're going to grow tomatoes, if you're going to whatever you're going to grow, before you even plant it, you're taking into consideration how the pest that can affect your crop and how you can best control that pest through how you plant it, how you water, how you fertilize, the timing of any chemical sprays, and the actual types of chemicals you're going to select from. And there's many, many different types of chemicals. Some chemicals are organic, can be used in conjunction with broad spectrum materials. Of course, generally you want to stay away from live drugs that buckle materials are contained, because they often disrupt biological control and make the control of other insects, non-target insects, far more difficult. So, really, the principles of IPM is to set an action threshold. And what that really means, and wasn't taken into consideration in the past, is that you can live with a few insects on a crop or in a garden. And at what point do you need to actually do anything about the pest? If it's in such small numbers that it doesn't affect the yield of your crop, or it's really not hurting the appearance of your plant materials, do you need to do anything? And the answer is, well, if it's not hurting, then live with it. You don't need to have a sterile plant where you've killed every insect on it. Sterile in the sense that you've eliminated every single insect that might be on that plant. Actually having a little bit of pest can be good, because then those little bit of pests are being eaten by the biocontrol agent. So you're actually keeping it balanced. You have a little bit of pest and a little bit of biocontrol agent, whether it be wasps or ladybug beetles or lacewings or pirate bugs or whatever they are. You by saying that you can have a few insects in your plants, then you don't go out and spray until the level of the pest is at your action threshold. And now for agriculture, that means at what point is the population so high that you're going to have a reduction in yield. Often that can be a number of insects per leaf, or some may way of going out and measuring the insect population, pest population, and then when it gets to a certain level, that's when you spray. You don't spray on a calendar basis. You don't say, well, it's the first of the month, I go out and spray. It's the 15th of the month, I go out and spray. You actually, instead of doing that, you go out and you use a sweep net and you catch your insects, or you go out and look at the leaves and you count how many insects per leaf. You sample your field, and if it's below the action threshold, then you don't have to spray. That's going to save you a lot of money. It saves you the time, the fuel for operating the equipment in the field, saves you the cost of the chemical. And of course, it lowers the amount of chemicals that we're putting into the environment, which is really, really critical. So, part of that action threshold is to monitor and identify pests, and the correct identification of the pests is absolutely critical, because, you know, not all insects, weeds, and other living organisms require control. So, and often you can mistake a biocontrol agent for a pest, so correct identification is really important. The mealybug destroyer is the first one that comes to mind. Prevention is actually one of the key elements of integrated pest management. If there's a cultural practice that's going to make your pest worse, then you need to avoid that cultural practice. And a prime example of that would be over-fertilization, putting on too much nitrogen on your plant materials, stimulating tremendous new growth, and then ending up with a lot of insect pests. Now, behind me, what you can see, I don't have my photos with me. This actually looks like a mealybug, but I believe it's the mealybug destroyer. And that's why I say it's so important to correctly identify your pest, because you may mistake this particular insect for a pest when in fact it's running around eating other mealybugs. And if you want a little tip on just differentiating the two, is mealybugs don't move. They move very slowly or not at all. Where the mealybug destroyer will look like a mealybug, but it will move around rather rapidly, not as fast as a small spider or something real fat, but they actually are rapid around because they're mobile and they're looking for something to eat, whereas the pest, the mealybug, is sitting stationary, sucking on the plant, and sucking juices out of the plant. So that's important for identification. Now, so for prevention, you know, it's, you know, don't do things that are going to make it worse. A lot of times people call me and they're having a problem with their landscape. And if you've watched the show in the past, you know my first question is, how are you irrigating your landscape? How are you watering your lawn? How often are you watering your fruit trees? How are you doing that? Because if you're watering it properly, you're going to create the problem that you have to deal with later. So, if it's so important to correctly irrigate your landscape. Because if you keep it too wet, you're going to probably end up with root rot. If you keep it too dry, you drop stress materials, then you're going to be attacked by other types of insects. And that would be particularly true on things like pine trees. If you don't water them, periodically, or you keep them bone dry all summer, then they get on the drop stress and they're subject to attack by bark beetle. So how do you think what's the primary wound use of the 20 bar peel? A good monthly soak of the tree. For several hours, soak it down to a depth of 2 to 3 feet, get a good soak, and then let it dry out for 4 weeks. And then you can water once a month. For large pines, you can water once a month for many large shade trees. Whereas if you're watering frequently, you can develop root rot. So that you can prevent bark beetle attack, and you can prevent root rot by watering properly. So that's prevention. Now, in that setting, you also have a lot of other things to consider. And that is, is this field a good field for me to plant my crop? A lot of times you rotate. If you have a pest problem in that field, and it keeps getting worse and worse every year, often you rotate to another field to avoid the pest. So there's also avoidance, avoiding the pest entirely. Now, control. Control really involves applying some type of treatment to control the pest. If you're lucky, you can release a biocontrol agent. Or if somebody has already done that biocontrol agent has become established in the environment. You don't need to apply it because it's already out there, and generally speaking, when that is successful, then you see very little of the pest because the biocontrol agent is keeping it under control. Sometimes in those situations, you may have a brief period during the year where the pest population comes up a little bit, and the biocontrol agent follows. Maybe that it's too cold in the spring for the biocontrol agent, whereas the pest is doing fine. So you have that brief period in the spring when you see the pest, but very quickly after that, the biocontrol agent, typically the most common ones, of course, are these small person wasps, they become active and they control the pest. So it's a good idea if you know that biocontrol agent is going to come along later and control the pest, don't go in and spray with a broad spectrum insecticide, you're going to wipe out your biocontrol wasp that's just starting to bring the pest under control, and then you wipe the whole thing out. And you disrupted the whole thing. So, now if you go on Wikipedia and read about IPM, they have very similar types of definitions for the various aspects or parts of a program. You have an acceptable pest handle, which would be your economic threshold. You have preventive cultural practices, that would be how you water, how you fertilize, what time you plant, that type of thing. Monitoring, going out and checking the population. You can have mechanical controls, but that's really part of control. That's not a separate category. Really under control, you have mechanical controls, you have biological controls, you have chemical controls. But those are all part of control, and then there's strategy, and then there's actual tactics. The strategy would be using resistant root stocks or resistance to control plant diseases. But a tactic would be which actual plants you're going to use. A strategy would be use chemical controls. The tactic is what chemicals. Now, just an interesting historical note about integrated pest management. This was really developed in reference to insect pests because of the widespread use of broad-spectrum insecticides after World War II. Historically, plant pathologists worked very closely with plant breeders to develop resistant plant material because the principal means of controlling plant diseases in agriculture has always been resistant plant material. And that is because even if there was a chemical control for that particular disease that you were dealing with, it often was far too expensive and was more expensive to apply the treatment than the crop was actually worth. So in many instances, and still today, it doesn't pay to treat. You have to use resistant plant materials. You have to do everything you can to control the disease, but spray, because the spray is just ineffective, and particularly in large fields of crops, or crops with extremely enormous acreage. Things like wheat, and cotton, and corn, and potato. Depending on the pest or the disease, some of those instances, you can't afford to spray for the disease. In cotton, there's very little wood. there are chemicals that control it. It doesn't, you can't afford to treat the cotton with that. So you have to use an integrated control strategy, and it doesn't include chemicals. It's all cultural practices. And wheat, one of the major diseases of wheat is wheat stem rust. There are chemicals that control wheat stem rust, but you cannot possibly spray the wheat and really recover square miles, not acreage, when you're treating hundreds of square miles. You can't spray that. With a chemical, it costs more than the value of the wheat. So how do you control wheat stem rust? You use resistant wheat varieties that are developed by the United States Department of Agriculture and by other research scientists at various agricultural universities across the United States. And they are constantly breeding and developing new resistant wheat varieties to control wheat stem rust. They don't use chemicals. So, that's just an example. So, pharmacologists have always used integrated control strategies. We didn't call it that back in the 50s and 60s, and this term was coined almost exclusively for the use of, you know, originally for insects. Now, so, that will each plant and develop an ideal strategy for that. It gets a little more difficult for a home garden. Home gardens have a wide diversity of plants, and so, you'll often get the same suite of insects parasitizing your plants and feeding on your plants. And I've talked about it in a previous show. We have aphids and mealybugs and thrips, scale insects. Those are all sucking insects. There's also psyllids. There's a whole bunch of them. And you can expect on certain types of plant material, you're going to get those every year. So for citrus, every spring, you're going to get aphids and mealybug and white fly and scale. Every spring you're going to get those. You get a big flush of green growth, and that tender growth, the aphids love it. So you go out there and it's covered with aphids in March, and you need to do something about it. For those sucked insects, you can just wash them off with a strong stream of water. That is a little tedious. If you've got a lot of plants, you might not have the time to do that. Of course, it has no residual, and they'll be back rapidly within the next week to 10 days or even 14 days, roughly. And so, but there are some chemical controls that make it a little easier to control those, or I should say there are some products that you can select to spray for the common sucking insects, and I've brought in some examples of those, and I've mentioned them in previous shows. And let's take a look at some of those products and talk about them. Now, the first thing I want to talk about is an organic product. And almost everything I'm going to start with is organic and non-toxic, because I always recommend those first. And this is, this one here is called, this is from Safer, and it's called Caterpillar Killer. And I'm going to put it like this so you can get it on the overhead. And Caterpillar Killer is actually a bacteria, and it's called Bacillus thuringiensis. And I don't know if you can see the active ingredients, but right down here, at the bottom, you can always read your active ingredients, and I encourage you, anybody who's buying a product and control a pest, to thoroughly read the label and read the application instructions, because you can either damage your plant material or you can waste your the product if you don't apply it properly. And so, the active ingredient is, as it states here, Bacillus thuringiensis. It's known as BT. It's not much of it in here. It's 12.7% BT. Now, BT can be purchased as a powder. This particular one is a liquid. It works, it has a very narrow range. It controls caterpillars. It also controls, there are strains of BT that control things like mosquitoes and black flies and fungus gnat. So some of the strains, the Chrysotaki strain, which is sold under the name BioBit or Dipel, MVP, Steward, or Thoracide. Those are very good for the vegetable insects. That's cabbage worm, which of course is a caterpillar and turns into a moth. The cabbage rooper, the imported cabbage worm, the diamondback moth. And of course, if you ever grow tomatoes, you almost certainly have seen either the tomato or the tobacco hornworm. Those become very large sphinx moths. They do a lot of damage to a tomato. BT will completely control that overnight. As soon as the caterpillar eats a little bit of the bacteria, it will stop feeding and it will die within 2 to 3 days. So this is non-toxic to humans or minimalist entirely. It is very selective, and if you spray it on a plant material, it will only really control caterpillars. There are strains that you can put in water to control mosquitoes and midges and things like that. The Israelita strain is the one that's used for mosquitoes, black fly, fungus gnat. There is a San Diego strain that actually controls some beetles, the Colorado potato beetle, the elm leaf beetle, and the cottonwood leaf beetle. So that's sold under the name Trident, or M1, or M-Track, Foil, Notodar. So you can actually find some BT strains that are effective against other things besides caterpillars, but for the most part, it's for caterpillars. And so it is a caterpillar strain. And I just, before I move on to the next pesticide, I just want to mention that there was an article in the Times over the weekend talking about BT cotton. And BT cotton is cotton that's been genetically engineered, which means they've taken the gene from another organism and cloned that gene and then put it into the cotton. It's just a form. I don't know what BT corn. I don't know if I said BT cotton. I'll say BT cotton. So BT corn carries the gene for the toxin that the bacteria makes. Whenever a caterpillar then feeds in the corn, it dies because it eats the toxin. Now, the corn seed is actually, that seed, BT corn seed, is more expensive than regular corn seed. But the article is really interesting because what it said was that the benefits of growing the BT cotton transfer to the non-BT, say cotton, the benefits of growing BT corn transfer to non-BT corn because it knocks down the population of the caterpillar, of the moth, and then there's fewer of them in the environment to parasitize the corn that's not protected by the genetic engineering. Now, USDA required corn growers who grew BT corn to have rows of non-BT corn around the transgenic corn in order to try to keep a lot of the moths around that wouldn't develop resistance. It was a means to try and prevent resistance to BT. And so, but the research that they just published recently shows that there's actually benefits to the other corn, and you can grow more of that corn, and you'll have less of the corn borer just by having the BT corn growing next door. And most of that BT corn, not sold for human consumption, that's almost exclusively used for the use of either, I guess it's approved for animal feed, but it's also used for ethanol production, or to make alcohol. So that's BT. That's usually one of the first ones I recommend if you're dealing with a caterpillar pest, and there's a lot of caterpillar pests. Moths are one of the most important pests. Now let's see. I want to talk about orillas. And I want to look here. One of the oils, I want to get out an oil. And this is, that's another product. Here's an oil. Spray oil. This is from, I'm not sure who manufactures this offhand. This says horticultural and dormant spray oil. The active ingredient is, I can hardly read it, it's so small. That's an oil. Now, the oils are all non-toxic, and let's take a look at this. And you can see all season spray oil. The oils are non-toxic to mammals, and it's useful for organic use. So you can spray this actually on, peach trees or edible type plant materials, vegetable crop. You can spray it in the morning, and you can harvest the same day. You just rinse it off. The oil itself is harmless. Some of the oils you'll see now are, most of them are horticultural oils, or they're short chain paraffin oils. Some of them now are things like mint oil or garlic oil, things like that. They all work the same way. They are miscible in water, and you spray it, and it coats the insect, and it prevents it from breathing. And that's how you kill the insects. They are contact insecticides. The BT is not a contact insecticide. BT you spray on the leaf and the caterpillar eats it and it dies. So BT works really well in that way. You don't have to actually spray it right on the caterpillar. Oils, you have to spray right on the caterpillar, right on the insect pest. So if you're trying to control aphids, you need to hit the aphids and that will kill them. And the oils have almost no residual activity, so you typically have to repeat the spray fairly frequently, especially if you're spraying citrus in the spring for aphids and bugs or other common sucking insects. But what you want to do is spray once a week for about 3 weeks, starting about March. And the other caveat about oils is they cannot be used in hot weather, generally anything over 90 degrees. The oils can burn the foliage in hot weather. So you can't use oils on a hot day. So the spring is the best time to use them. The other is you know, for ag production, oils actually do have an adverse effect. They diminish the growth rate and can adversely affect yield if you use them a lot. So some of the growers are reluctant to use the oils. There's also Volk oil, very commonly sprayed, available at most garden centers, Sunspray Ultrafine. There's Genius Styling Oil, which also has the benefit of controlling things like powdery mildew, rust, and black spot. They're very good for mite control if you've got a mite problem on, say, on tomato. There's a lot of mites that get on vegetable production. Oils are very good for controlling mites. Neem oil has become very popular, and it's improves a lot of insect pests. But it also is reported and labeled for black spot, powdery mildew, anthracnose, and rust. So these are very good for roses in the spring. Roses always get covered with aphids first thing in the spring. And so once a week with this, for about 3 weeks, you clean it up, you knock them way down, and then you monitor. And usually over a 2 to 4 week period, they'll start to come back. And you may have to spray it again sometime in May or June. If you can get into July, often the foliage is hardened off. There's a lot of biocontrol agents out there controlling it. You may not need to spray it again. Oils have the least impact on beneficials. So this is one of the first things I recommend for the common sucking insects, the soft-bodied sucking insects. And then there's also soap. And now this is another oil. This is Greenlight Home and Garden Insect Spray. This is actually mint oil. Let's get a picture of that if I can. There it is right there. The actual ingredient is mint oil. This is another product that you can get. I bought these at Target. You can get them at Home Depot. You can get them at Lowe's. You can get them at any garden center. And they're commonly available. So mint oil, clove oil, and sesame oil. Actually, this has three different oils in it. And there are non-toxic to mammals, and you can spray and harvest the same day. So there's two different oil products. One of these is this one here actually has a hose bib attachment. You just hook it up and spray. Real simple for most people. You can get concentrated oils where you're going to dilute it yourself and use a hose and a sprayer. This is a little pump spray. It's ready to use right out of the bottle. You can use this on the house pump. It's very, very convenient. But be careful. Don't use oils on a hot day. Soaps. I often mention soaps. And let's see which one of these is a soap. This is Roundup. It's not bad at all. I believe this is insect killing soap from Safer. And we'll take a look at this bottle. There we go. Insect killing soap with seaweed extract. I don't know how much the seaweed extract really helps, but maybe it's good marketing. Now let's see if they mention the soap on here. The ingredient is potassium salts and fatty acids. And for all you people who've had organic chemistry, you know that fatty acids are active soaps. Soaps are fatty acids, and that's how soaps work. And the way soaps, and this, you can actually just use dishwashing detergent. It works really, really well. You can use Dawn, you can use any dishwashing detergent. Now, don't use detergent used for washing clothes. That's a little too harsh. You know, typically, you can burn your plants if you use that. But the Safer insecticide soap, or dishwashing detergent, and there's other manufacturers of soap products. The way soaps kill insects is they integrate with the membrane of the insect and cause it to leak. Membranes on animals and insects are made up of fatty acids. And so when you put fatty acid on it, it slips into the membrane, and then that disrupts the membrane, and it leaks, and then the insect dies. So soaps are very, very effective. I just use soapy water to clean up any ants that might get on my cabinet. Bugging me to death, but the soap kills ants instantly, and so ants are actually important to control in the landscape too. But before I talk about that, let's continue on to the various products. So here's soap. If you combine a concentrated soap solution Or if you get oil and soap, you combine them together, they are more effective than using them alone. The soaps typically won't burn as easily as oils. So a little safer to use on a hot day, but be very careful on any hot day using any product. It's always best to let it cool off. And don't treat dry plants. If a plant is wilted, you can't put a product on it. You need to water it, let it hydrate, get it good and wet, and then treat it. It's always much safer. So that's safer insecticidal soap. So soaps and oils, very, very effective at controlling the soft-bodied sucking insects. But some of the other insects are more difficult to control, especially the scale insects, which are also a sucking insect. And the reason is that the scale insects have a covering over them. If you've ever seen scale on a leaf, or on a branch, you'll see this covering. And then we spray a soap or oil, it actually doesn't get to the insect. The insect is underneath. Now, it will help control their population if the fawning stage is present at that time. And so, soaps and oils can be effective at controlling the populations, but generally, you have to use a broad spectrum insecticide to really get the scale insects. The other product that I want to mention are the pyrethrins. And this is a pyrethrin product right here. This is a multi purpose yard and garden insect killer. It's, I guess, from EasyGon. I picked this up at Kmart. You can find similar products at many, many different garden centers. But if you look at the ingredient, it says permethrin. And so, what is permethrin? Those are pyrethrins and pyrethroids are the group. And, that's why I sit down here, active ingredient. Look at your active ingredients and know what you're using. So, pyrethrins and pyrethroids. Pyrethrin is made from chrysanthemum, a species of chrysanthemum. It is a neurotoxin that attacks the nervous systems of all insects. Most insects are highly susceptible to pyrethrins, so very low concentrations are applied. And since it's made from a plant material, it's considered natural and it has an organic label. But that doesn't mean it's totally non-toxic. Pyrethrins are quite non-toxic to most animals, making them among the safest insecticides in use. But there are heightened concerns recently about pyrethrins and pyrethrins getting into waterways. Pyrethrins usually break down rapidly after application. They are contact insecticides, so you need to spray a couple times, two or three times, to get used to this. Some of our beneficials are actually fairly tolerant of pyrethroids, such as lace wings. But grass-seed wasps and predatory mites and beetles can be very susceptible to this. So, depending on what you're doing, you need to take that into account. Some of the other products that contain pyrethrins are Ambush and Pounce. But you can find pyrethrins labeled under many, many different labels and they're very commonly available in any garden or nursery store. Another one that was very popular for a long time was rotenone. I don't think I actually have a bottle of rotenone. This is one of the oldest vital botanical insects, insecticides. It was used originally as a fish poison. It's derived from a South American species called the genus is Leucocarpus. It is primarily used for various leaf-feeding caterpillars and beetles such as caterworms and Colorado potato beetle. It is moderately toxic to animals and highly toxic to fish and aquatic life. It lasts about 6 days in the environment, so it does have some residual activity. So if you still have some rotenone in your garden shed or in your garage, you can go ahead and use it. But there is a tenuous link to some human problems, particularly Alzheimer's. I think it was Alzheimer's or Parkinson's disease, now I forget the actual link. And it was no longer approved as an organic pesticide as of 2005, so about 5 years ago. But rotenone was very popular as an organic pesticide for a long, long time. So, some of you may not want to use rotenone because of that link. You may be worried about it now. If that's true, you can take it one of the chemical roundups that the Los Angeles County Public Works Department holds on a regular basis. Now, this is the next one I want to talk about, spinosad. Spinosad, I've recommended that several times to some of the people calling. I remind you that we're live and on the air, calling with a question. And let's talk about your garden. I'm so sure I don't have this season. At least it's one spot, I've never even opened it. Some of these bottles are really empty because I'm using them. Here's our next product. This is from Monterey Garden. It's called Monterey Garden Insect Spray. And the active ingredient is spinosad. This is also labeled organically, and it has a rather unique purpose. It is a very, very good product for chewing insects. That would be beetles, grasshoppers, caterpillars, but it is not effective on sucking insects like aphids and mealybugs and thrips and sieves and scale. And the reason is, you spray it on the plant, on the leaf, and the chewing insect comes and starts eating the leaf and chewing away at it. And they digest the spinosad, and that actually, we have to get enough of it to kill them. And sucking insects don't eat the leaf, and so they just are sitting there sucking on the leaf, and they won't really get any of the poison. So it doesn't work on aphids and that type of sucking insect, but it works very well for grasshoppers and beetles. And there are some beetles that are big problems. The palm leaf beetle, the potato beetle, Colorado potato beetle, and they will do a lot of damage if you don't bring them under control. These are very small beetles, and they can do quite a bit of damage. Spinosad is made from an actinomycete. The actual name is Saccharopolyspora spinosa. It is collected from soil in an abandoned rum distillery on a Caribbean island in 1982. And that's the only time that soil bacteria was ever discovered. No one's ever found it again. And it must be ingested by the insect. That means they have to eat it to consume it in order for it to be effective. It will also move through the leaf cuticle to reach leaf miner larvae. So this is also registered for leaf miners. And if you've got, you know, I used to grow a lot of zinnias and marigolds, and they always have a lot of leaf miner. And if you take one of those leaves and put it in a jar and wait, the insect that's in the leaf, it's going to be a larva of some form. It's inside the leaf, tunneling around in the leaf. And then when it pupates and emerges, it will typically be a fly, but it could also be a moth. Those are the two most common groups that leaf miners belong to. It has very little effect on things like lacewings, ladybug beetles, pirate bugs, predatory mites. It's a good product in that sense. It's a soft pesticide. It is fairly specific to things like beetles and grasshoppers, and it will not eliminate a lot of the beneficials. So it is organically labeled. It is toxic to bees when the flower is just wet, or if you spray it around the bee, actually. But it's relatively safe for them once it dries. So if you spray it on the foliage and it dries, then the bees can forage on flowers and they won't have a problem. There are some beneficial wasps that are susceptible or hurt by spinosad. It has an extremely high, what we call LD50, 5,000 milligrams per kilogram in rats and mice. That is actually explaining what that means. The LD, every chemical is assessed. Its toxicity is assessed. You want to know how toxic a chemical is. And this is not something that is just from pesticides, but it's all chemicals. Many chemicals are used in industrial processes. And they will, for every chemical that's manufactured, they have what's called an MSDS sheet, a manufacturer safety dash sheet. It tells how toxic it is. It tells how flammable it is. It tells all the problems that can occur with it. It tells the chemical structure and all sorts of things. And on that sheet, you'll find the LD50. And also, it can report several different LD50s, one for oral ingestion, one for dermal exposure, if it's absorbed through the skin. And the lower the LD50, the lower that number, the more toxic it is. Because what it is it says how many milligrams per kilogram of body weight is required to kill half of the test animals. So they might put on, give it to rats or give it to mice, and they'll give it a little dose, and you might kill 10%. They get a little more dose, and you kill 30%. And then do a higher dose, and they finally give you the dose, that kills 50% of the test animals. And that's called the LD50, the lethal dose at which 50% of the test animals are killed. So the lower that number, the less you need to kill 50% of the animals. Anything under 50 milligrams per kilogram is considered highly toxic. If you're between 50 to 250, that's moderately toxic. And if you're above 250 milligrams per kilogram, that's considered less toxic. Now, and so aspirin has an LD50, as any chemical. And aspirin's LD50 is greater than 5,000, which means 5,000 milligrams or 5 grams of the material per kilogram of body weight. That's extremely high. The LD50 for spinosad, for mammals, for rats and mice, is 5,000 milligrams per kilogram. Right? So this is an extremely low toxicity material. It's not non-toxic, because nothing's really non-toxic. You can even kill yourself if you drink too much water. And here we have a grasshopper behind me, and you know grasshoppers can be a little difficult to control. So some of the other things that this controls, of course, the caterpillars. It can control thrips and leaf binders and borers and chewing beetles. Little effect on sunlight insects, as I mentioned before, and very little effect on non-target beneficial insects, these potato bug beetles, lace wings, pyro bugs. It was approved for organic use in 2003, so it's been used under that as an organic pesticide for a long time. It's sold under a whole bunch of names. Of course, this one is Monterey Garden Insect Spray, but you can also find it as Spintor, Conserve, Green Light, Lawn, and Garden Spray, spinosad GF120 fruit fly bait. And that's actually a nice material. That GF120 fruit fly bait is really good for controlling the olive fruit fly. Now, the olive fruit fly was introduced back in the 90s and quickly spread throughout Southern California. And will just absolutely invest 100% of the olives on an olive tree. If you want to process your olives for, and eat them, they'll ruin it. So, what you do with the, you get that GF120 fruit fly bait, you just spray one branch of half the tree, and then you can alternate. And you don't have to spray that often. I think you spray on about a 15 to 20 day schedule. And so, with GF120 fruit fly bait, it has the tracker, and the fruit flies underneath that, the spinosad, and it controls it. You start on the olives, if I can digress more about the olive, you don't have to spray the olives until about June. The fruit flies won't start laying their eggs in the olives until about, until what they call pit hardening. That's when the pit of the olive starts to harden, that's when the fruit flies will lay their eggs. That occurs in June. So you don't have to spray your olives in the spring, but you do have to spray fairly often throughout the rest of the season until harvest. So we never knew there were so many people processing their olives until that fruit fly showed up, and everyone started calling asking how to control it. What else about spinosad? It has a 4-hour reentry and a 1-day harvest interval. So if you use this, you're not supposed to harvest for a day. That's a very short harvest interval. Many of the products that you find out there, some of the broad spectrum pesticides and insecticides, will have even a 7-day, 14-day, or even a 3-month harvest interval. So that's very short. The test formulation of spinosad is approved for organic farms by the Organic Materials Review Institute. The next product I want to talk about, I don't have an actual container for you to show you, is abamectin. Abamectin is produced by the soil bacterium Streptomyces, a species of Streptomyces. It is very highly toxic material, but its formulations have low toxicity in mammals. In fact, the oral LD50 for abamectin in rats is 11 milligrams per kilogram body weight. That is highly toxic. That really is toxic. But the actual product that they sell, a fern, the LD50 for a fern, for fire ant bait, at 0.011%, that's 0.011% abamectin in rats is greater than 5,000 milligrams per kilogram body weight. So if you actually take the product, it's extremely non-toxic because they use so little of it. It's relatively non-toxic to birds. Abamectin is highly toxic to fish and aquatic invertebrates, and that's generally true of many of the pesticides. Fish and aquatic organisms are often far more sensitive to these products than mammals or birds. And that's something just kind of digress briefly. That really, I think, is related to the fact that they're in an aqueous environment. They're exposed to more of it. It gets into the water and it's just, they get a bigger dose of it. So you have to be very careful with using any of your products. Try not to get them into the waterway. If you've got a pond, if you've got a pool, if you've got fish in your garden, be very, very careful with these products because you can end up harming your fish quite easily. It is, abamectin is rapidly degraded by light, and it has a very strong tendency to bind to soil particles. That's actually considered a very good characteristic. You want things that don't migrate down through the soil profile and end up in the water table. That's often a very big problem, is if you apply something as a soil treatment or a plant material, and it ends up in the soil, and then it gets washed and leached through the soil down into the water table, and then that's a big problem. So it's actually good when any of these products adhere strongly to the soil particles, then it won't leach out and end up in the water table. It's more difficult for it to actually leave the site where it's been applied. It will break down in the soil over time, and often very rapidly. Abamectin is fairly insoluble in water, and it's immobile in the soil because it adheres strongly to the soil particles. Some of the trade names that you can purchase abamectin: Affirm, Agrimax, Avid, and many others. Abamectin is not approved as an organic pesticide, and it is a very expensive material. It's used for the most part, abamectin is really used in agricultural production. Now, those are really some of the more the safest and things I recommend first when you're trying to control pests, insect pests or mice. But there are also the organophosphates. Now, organophosphates are more traditional insecticides. They are cholesterase inhibitors. There's an enzyme that's used in nerve transmission. And so, let's see what I've got. I've got one of them. I've got diazinon. This is an old bottle of diazinon. Diazinon is no longer sold to homeowners. It's not, this is an old bottle of diazinon. Very, very effective at controlling insects. The ones you can still buy are malathion and ornithine. Those are also organophosphates. They usually have fairly higher toxicity. They're often maybe 200 to 500, I think malathion is about 700. So not highly toxic, but still significantly toxic. And if you give yourself a good dose of that, you'll get sick. You'll have headache, dizziness, nausea. These are the typical symptoms from poisoning yourself with an organophosphate. They will kill anything you spray them on. Now, this is just one bottle I've had for actually years and years and years. I rarely ever use it. I use it in very, very limited situations. I often will get the Argentina ants coming in and getting into some of my house plants, and that's when I use it. I'll mix up a little tiny bit of it, and I'll do a drench in the soil on a pot that has Argentina, and that'll just fight them out. Actually, I don't do that first. I try a little soapy water first. I try to soak them in water and get them out of there. But if you really have a lot of plants, and you're getting into quite a few of your house plants, and the Argentinians love to come in and colonize these pots, especially my orchids. They're right into my orchid pots. They love that bark mix that you grow orchids in. The diazinon works really well for that. But I just happen to have a bottle of it. You can't buy this anymore. You can get malathion, and you can get ornithine. Malathion is weaker than diazinon. Typically is used to control insects on roses and other shrubs and stuff like that. You spray it on your lawn to control some of the grubs that will get into the lawn and do damage to the lawn. Those are the organophosphates. So the problem, one of the problems with these organophosphates, and actually it's a big problem, is they kill everything on the bush. And they have a strong impact on the beneficials. So when you come in and spray with this, you will get rid of your pests. But you're probably going to get rid of predatory mites. You're going to get rid of ladybug beetles and lacewings and pirate bugs. You're going to kill everything on the bush. And then you're going to, what often happens is within a few weeks, you have a big problem with mics feeding on the plant, because you wiped out everything that was controlling the mic. You might have gotten rid of the agents, and now you got a mic problem. So, you gotta be careful when you use these. I only recommend things like organic phosphates and next group are the carbamates. I don't think I brought a bottle of 7, but that's the most typical carbamate now available to home gardeners. So, the problem with the organic phosphates is they really do disrupt bio control. They become a real problem. Diazinon now is only labeled for organic, for agricultural use. It's no longer permitted for sale to homeowners. The problem with diazinon was the lawn applications. And what happened was quite a few times there was applied either in a park or in a golf course or in a cemetery for lawns. And then right after the application, there's a big flock of birds land on the lawn and they'd be feeding on the lawn. Either eating insects or seed or whatever that particular species of bird would eat. And birds are highly sensitive to diazinon. And you get big bird kills. And so that kind of did it in. That's kind of a trend when chemicals are removed from the marketplace, is that there's been kind of an event that happened in the news. And, you know, when Vapam was a sulfugate that was. Available to homeowners, and then a train of tanker cars filled with Vapam went into the river up there by Lake Shasta. I guess it was, I don't know if it's the Sacramento River or the National River, but feeds into Lake Shasta. I don't think it's called the Shasta River. That just sterilized the whole river. And that was a huge event. It got a lot of press, and then Vapam was removed from the marketplace for hormone use. It still is allowed for ag use, although extremely regulated, and you've got to jump through a lot of hoops in order to be allowed to use that. The other broad spectrum insecticides are carbamates, and there's one still left in the market for hormone use. It's Carbaryl. It's the trade name is 7 SEVIN. And again, you know, it's very effective at controlling the target insect, but it will it will disrupt biocontrol. It will kill everything on the bush. It's kind of the atomic bomb of your pesticides. You only use it when you're kind of forced to use either 7 or you're forced to use malathion, because, you know, generally the group that's most probably where you kind of really come in and use that would be for the scale insects. The scale insects are extremely hard to control, which is soaps and oils. You can control their populations, you can knock them down, but you're not going to really eradicate them. And if you've got a real heavy scale infestation, I used to get really heavy scale infestations on my cymbidium orchids. Sometimes in my citrus, I see a lot of scale. And so sometimes I might be tempted to use one of those. But it's very rarely. In fact, I use almost no chemicals in my yard. Not that I'm ready to be organic. I'm not ready to be an organic. And IPM is not organic. I didn't mention that before. Often people think integrated pest management means organic pest management. Organic pest management is much more strict than IPM. Organic means you don't use anything that's not organic labeled. And that means, you know, none of these broad spectrum insecticides. IPM means reduce the use of the broad spectrum insecticides and fungicides as much as possible. And only use for them when you have to. When the economic threshold has been reached, and you've got to bring them under control. Now the other one that I want to show is, let's see what this is. Okay, there's two of them actually, but I'll show you this first one. This is imidacloprid, the neonicotinoids. Now, nicotine used to be used extensively as an insecticide. There were many products that nicotine was the active ingredient. And that was all pulled off the market a long time ago. And it was, I don't think it was banned. There really are no more nicotine-based insecticides sold in California. They're just not manufactured or sold at all. And now if you have a look at the neonicotinoids, and they have the same active mode of action as nicotine, so they're called neonicotinoids. And the one that's most widely used right now is called imidacloprid. It is the homeowner packaging for imidacloprid. I'm not sure if you guys can see that on the camera. I'll say there it is. This is Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub, and it is, I believe, about 1.5%, 1.47% imidacloprid. And imidacloprid is sold under a lot of labels and names. This is the homeowner packaging that you can purchase it. And of course, you can see it's quite blue. It's 1.47% imidacloprid. They always do this. For the ag use people, they'll sell it in a very concentrated form. So the same product, imidacloprid, is sold under the Merit for commercial applications. Merit is labeled for ornamentals. It comes as a white powder. It's 75% imidacloprid, so it's rather concentrated. But you dilute it extensively, and it can either be sprayed on the foliage or it can be applied to the roots as a drainage, and then the plant will take it up from the roots and up into the shoots of the plant, and it will last a long time. If you treat a big tree or shrub with this, it will last 12 months or even up to 18 months. So it's very good for things like roses that get a lot of insects in the spring, and if you don't have the time, or in commercial settings where it's a commercial building and they got roses out front and they want them to look real good and they really can't go out there and spray every week with an oil or soap and then come back in 4 weeks and spray again. They want one application, it's going to last 12 months. They're not going to have any insects at all on that plant material or any pest insects at all on that plant material for the whole year. So, it all depends on how you want to manage your garden. This is not labeled for edible plant material, this product. Merit is not only for edible plant material. It says for controlled insects on ornamentals and non-bearing fruit trees, that means flowering fruit trees, a flowering peach, or maybe very, very young fruit trees in nursery production where you don't expect to have any fruit in the next 12 months. It has a 3-month harvest interval. Actually, this product may actually have a longer harvest interval. I don't know why they put a harvest interval when it says don't put it on edible plants, but they do. This may actually have a 12-month harvest interval. Now, the same active ingredient, imidacloprid, is sold under the name Admire, under the label Admire, for use in agricultural production. And that label allows for a treatment of things like grape and citrus and avocado and vegetable production. It is used quite extensively in citrus production, and it works very well. A spring application, and you will really control all the insects on your tree for really the whole season. And it's not cheap. Some growers would prefer maybe not to use that because it's so expensive, and maybe to use other things. It is not organic, even though it is not the highest LD50. LD50 for imidacloprid is 450 milligrams per kilogram. So that's not very high. That's moderate toxicity. It is highly toxic to bees. But if you do it as a root branch, then the bees are not going to get any. Advantage for flea control on dogs and cats is imidacloprid is sold under the Advantage for dogs and cats. I want to remind our viewers that we're live and on the air, and our phone number is 1-800-339-1193. Call up and tell me what pests are in your garden or what products you've been using, and maybe there's some other products that would be better for your goal, or less toxic, or you wouldn't have to use as often. So give me a call. This is, we'll get back to the imidacloprid. Imidacloprid is very effective for both sucking and chewing insects. It is systemic. If you spray it in the foliage, it lasts about a month. It's absorbed into the leaves, and then anything that feeds on the plant will be controlled for about 30 days. If you use it as a root branch, it can be effective up to 12 months. It has very similar activity to nicotine. And nicotine, the LD50 was 50 milligrams per kilogram and has been barred in the U.S. I didn't realize it was actually barred. That was banned. There is still one nicotine-based pesticide. It's a fogger for greenhouse production. I don't know if it's used very much anymore, but the last time I checked, it was still available. So, there you go. These are all insecticides. I didn't bring any fungicides. Just briefly mentioned, there are a number of broad-spectrum fungicides that you can use, and there are some organic fungicides now. If you're trying to control powdery mildew, you can use potassium bicarbonate. That's now sold by Kellogg has an organic fungicide. It's very effective. You can also use milk and water to control powdery mildew on things like roses or crepe myrtle trees or any of this powdery mildew. I often see powdery mildew on squash, these pumpkins and cucumbers, not cucumbers, zucchini, yellow neck, things like that, patty pan. They get a lot of powdery mildew. If you don't control the powdery mildew on your squash, and we're getting late into the year for that, and so it's on for next spring. Control it, or it'll really hurt your plants. It's not good. Great, it's a lot of powdery mildew. So you can use the potassium bicarbonate, you can use milk, and those should do the job for you. You can also use neem oil or abamectin. Those are also effective. The other one that you might want to use for ornamentals, the things that are available to you in garden centers, would be Fungi-Ray or Fungi-X. Those are breast-effective fungicides, and if you're not getting good control with one of the others, or if you want to rotate, which is very good, not to use the same thing over and over again, because that does contribute to resistance developing in your target pest. So you might want to go with one of the broad spectrums on a very limited basis. But that was imidacloprid. Let's see what else we got here. Now, let's move on and talk about peach diseases. And let's talk about the integrated pest manager of the various diseases that you get on small fruits, and particularly on peach. Peach and nectarine. Nectarines are just peaches with fuzz. They're really the same thing. Just before I move on, this is the Bayer Advanced Garden Rose and Flower Care, and it also has imidacloprid in it, plus it has a systemic fungicide. So this is Bayer Advanced Garden Rose Care. This also has the imidacloprid in it for the insects, plus a fungicide for things like powdery mildew, rust, and black spot. And of course, this would probably be just applied once in the spring. I don't think you'd have to apply it very often. So that's really a very similar product to the tree and shrub. The other product they have in here is Roundup. I only use Roundup very rarely. I used it to kill my back lawns, convert it into a vegetable garden. Otherwise, you know, like St. Augustine and Bermuda mix, and if you don't really kill that lawn, it's just such a headache to try and keep it out during the season. So if you spray it down real good with Roundup, Roundup is very, very low toxicity to it. It's not, you know, some people want to blame it for a lot of problems. I don't really buy into that a whole lot. It's low toxicity. You don't have to use it very often. I wouldn't recommend you use it constantly, but I do use it when I'm eliminating a lawn. And I should say this more often, clear your lawn. Lawns use about 4 feet of water a year, 3 to 4 feet of water a year. You get mold every week. They get lots of fungal diseases. They get insect problems. You'd be much better off with a ground cover than if you had low water use ground cover. You don't have to mow, especially if you don't really use your lawn to walk on it, like a front lawn. How many people really walk on their front lawns all that much? It's really there, you just walk past it every morning on the way to work, and in the evening when you walk back up to the front door. Well, let's take a look at some of the peach diseases, and we'll talk about how to control them. Peachy curl, let's go with the first picture, which is number 4. And take a look, bring this up full screen. This is peach leaf curl. Peach leaf curl is a fungal disease caused by a fungus called Toxophila. And it survives in the bark in a yeast-like phase. And it can grow either in the plant like a filamentous fungus, or it will grow on the bark and reproduce like a yeast. Once in the spring, when the new foliage comes out, it affects the new growth, and it causes the blister. This is a blister. And it often has this red coloring to it in here, and it puffs it up. It can cause curling. Curled leaves can be, just plain old curled leaves, they're usually aphids feeding on it. And here's another picture of it, number 5. Let's take a look at that. It shows, I'll bring it up full screen. And you can see the blisters forming here and here, and this one's quite red in here. That's peach leaf curl. This is really a nuisance disease on the peaches in Southern California. If we don't have a rainy winter, we'll have very little to none of it. And even when it rains, we just get a little bit of it. So, now, up north, in Northern California, or in Washington, or any place where you grow peaches, we get a lot of spring and early fall. This is a very serious disease, because these leaves will fall off the tree once they get infected. So it causes defoliation. And so if you defoliate a peach tree, that's really hard on any tree to be defoliated, especially if it gets defoliated repeatedly. So you can control this disease. Unfortunately, the control is quite simple, because if you control it during the winter when the tree is dormant, when it's overwintering in bud scales and in the bark as a yeast, then you'll get almost no peach tree curl in the spring. And you can do that with a dormant oil with sulfur. Usually one spray in December or January when the tree is dormant, there's no leaves left on it, you've already had leaf fall, so the tree has no leaves on it, and you spray the trunk and branches with a dormant oil and sulfur, and that would be an organic treatment. And you can use rope oil or any other dormant oil. If it's a very wet winter, you want to do that twice, but in a normal winter, you can just do it once. And that will really clean up the tree, and you won't have any of the tap fire, or very little of it, available in the spring when the tree starts to fluff out with new growth and it's raining, and that's when that new growth will get infected. So it's easy to control. That's peach leaf curl. You don't really need to have an integrated plant for peach leaf curl because just the dormant oil and sulfur is so effective. And of course, peach leaf curl, the fungus tap fire and deformities doesn't develop any resistance to oil and sulfur, that just doesn't happen. The next disease I want to talk about on peaches is brown rot of peach. Now, brown rot is a really serious disease, and it can be a big problem down here, as well as in agricultural production. And the fungus that causes it is Monilia fruticola and Monilia laxa. And this picture is of a fruit mummy, which means it's a shriveled up fruit in the spring, that produces what we call apothecia, or these little cups. And these little cups that you see can be about the size of a dime or a little smaller. And lining the cup are these microscopic sacs. And in each sac, there's 8 spores. And when the wind blows, or if you bump it, they shoot into the air. And so if you could take that, if I had that in my hand right now and just blew on it, or shook a little bit, you'd see a little puff come out of it. It looks like a little smoke or dust. Those are spores. Those spores float up into the air in the spring, and they land on the flowers, and they infect the flowers. And then it can move down the flower and into the twigs and cause a canker, a bleeding canker on the twigs. But what it also will do is infect the fruit when it's very small and young, but you won't see the infection. It's a latent infection. It won't start to hurt the fruit until the fruit starts to ripen. So the fruit gets infected in the spring, because the flower gets infected. You can destroy the flower and get more fruit, or it can just infect the fruit. Usually the petals die first and then the rest of the flower. You can get extensive biting of the twigs in apricots, cherries, plums, and prunes. But that's not on peach. That usually, peaches, you won't get a lot of blighting of the twigs. That means it is that the twigs die. Fruit rot first appears as small dark spots, and that usually happens right as the fruit starts to ripen in June or July, or in the late variety in August. And so you get these little tiny black spots on the fruit, or brown spots, and within a few days, those spots get bigger and bigger and bigger, and the whole fruit will turn brown and rot. So this brown discoloration spreads rapidly, and a grayish brown tuft of spores will develop on the surface of the rotted areas. And let's take a look at number 11. I know that I'm a little out of order, but let's look at 11. This is a brown rot peach. This is a peach that's been rotted by brown rot. And you can see that really the whole peach has lost so rapidly that you lose the whole peach. It's not like some of the other problems in fruit where you can cut it out. How do you control this? Well, you actually have to do a lot of things to control this, especially in areas where it rains every spring. One of the things about this is that if you don't get a flower infection, you're not going to get very many fruit infections, or really not. And so if you control it in the flower stage, you'll get nearly 100% control. And the real only way to control it, there's some things you've got to do to control it in the flower stage. One of them is a chemical application, a fungicide application when the tree is flowering. If it doesn't rain, you can actually just skip that. But what are the other things you can do to control brown rot? Well, the first thing is during the winter months when you're pruning, because you want to prune out about 60% of the wood every winter when you prune your stone fruits. That encourages rapid new growth. The new growth flowers better and produces more fruit. So that's why you prune peach trees and plum trees and apricots and nectarines and cherries. Why you prune them so hard every winter is to generate new growth. You don't do that to other shade trees because you're not, you know, it's not your goal. So in the winter, you want to prune out any infected twigs or branches, and you can tell they'll either be gumming or there'll be a dead spot in the branch. You want to remove any fruit lummies that are in the tree or on the ground. And that's shriveled up, dried up fruit. If they get brown rot and they fall on the ground, they'll shrivel up, they'll become little brown lummies. And that's the source of the inoculum in the spring to infect your flowers. So you want to keep all the weeds down. Don't let any weeds grow under your peach trees on these stone fruits. And then pick up any of the old fallen fruit, and it all goes in the trash, and it's going to the mulch pile. And then prune out any infected branches. And then that will go a long way in controlling your brown rot. Then, if it's raining when the tree flowers, you want to, what they do commercially, is use a broad spectrum fungicide. And maybe you can get away with potassium bicarbonate from Kellogg, I'm not sure. Then I'd try that if you want to use organic products only, or you could probably try the abamectin. But the thing is, when flower just starts to open, that's called first pink. That's when you can just see a little bit of pink, and the petals are now just exposed to the air. So what you want to do is protect the petals from getting infected. So right as that starts to open is your first spray. You usually spray two or three times while the tree is flowering. So once the first pink, once when they're, you know, mostly open, and then maybe a third time. But that's only necessary if it's raining while the tree is blooming. So here in Southern California, you often don't need to spray for brown rot if we're having a dry winter. Those of you who have a serious brown rot problem on your trees in the past are well advised to go ahead and spray anyway, because there may be something about your microclimate or you're close to somewhere that was confronted on your backyard peach tree. So you're getting a inoculum with a high inoculum load or a high disease pressure, is the one term that people used to use. So you probably want to go ahead and maybe give it one or two sprays with a fungicide. And there's a lot of fungicides available to choose from. Or you can try the oils. You can try maybe a neem oil, or you can try abamectin, or potassium bicarbonate, or who knows, maybe even milk and water. That's low on use for powdery mildews. I don't know how well that would work for brown rot. Talking about powdery mildew, peaches get powdery mildew as well, and it's caused by the fungus Serrafecia pannosa. Let's take a look at number 7, and you can see powdery mildew right on the peach, and you can see this, you know, it looks very much like powdery mildew on any plant that gets powdery mildew, such as roses you know, if it's on crepe myrtle, it gets, you know, but it's important to note that these fungi are host specific. The one here on peach actually molded on roses, but that's because they're both in the rose family. But it won't go to crepe myrtle, and it won't go to sycamore trees, and it won't go to other things that have powdery mildews. Usually powdery mildews are host specific. So the powdery mildew you see on grape bushes isn't going to jump over and get on your roses. The one on the roses doesn't jump over. They're different fungi. They are host specific. They're also referred to as obligate pathogens, which means they cannot complete their life cycle without their host. They have to grow on a living host in order to complete their entire life cycle. And if anyone has a question out there about their garden, you need to hurry up and call, because our show, we're running out of time and we haven't had any calls today. So, let's go to number 8, and I'll show you another picture of powdery mildew. Bring that up full screen and take a look at that. This is typical when you see powdery mildew on the fruit. If you start to see this in the spring, you really need to do something, because it can really, you'll lose an awful lot of fruit to that. It can get on the twigs and the new growth as well, not just the fruit. Although in my experience around here, I usually see it on the fruit first before I see it on the twigs and the branches. It may just be where I've gone. So it first appears as white net-like growth on the leaves or as white patches on the fruit. Severely affected leaves may curl and fall off. Do not grow roses close to stone fruits. They share the same powdery mildew. You know, commercial peach tree growers Peach growers will never grow roses close to their orchards. You can prune to discourage the development of dense canopies. If you have a very dense canopy, that can increase the severity of the disease. And you need to spray at the first sign of powdery mildew. Remove the infected foliage. First spray can be sulfur in the spring. In fact, it's almost always true for commercial production. And so, like I mentioned before, you can try milk or sourdough oil or neem oil if you want to be organic. And sulfur is also organic. So, you might be able to get a good hold on this with sulfur. Now, sulfur and oils are both a problem with hot out, over 90 degrees. So, you don't want to treat with sulfur later in the season. But try to get this under control right away in the spring. That was powdery mildew, and you can, your organic or your integrated control is to have a nice open canopy with good air movement, not have any roses nearby, and then use the sulfur in the spring, and then go with the oils also as a next spring, as your next treatment, and then maybe even just some soaps now that are coming out that control powdery mildew as well. I see we have a caller. Linda is calling from West Los Angeles. Linda, you're on the air.
Hi, Jerry.
Hi.
I have something growing on my porch, and I think it's a wasp. They're like little brown mounds, and they're around the light on the porch. And I was wondering what to use for that, and would it damage the lighting fixture and wires?
Well, the thing I would use is a wasp and hornet spray. A lot of the other products that I've seen on the market aren't, if you try to use one of the sprays here for roaches and ants, they're not effective on the wasps and hornets. You need to get a specific wasp hornet spray. They sell them in almost any garden center. They often have a very strong spray come out of a can. I mean, it's a real jet. It's not just a little mist. I don't think it'll be a problem for the light fixture. Do it early in the morning when it's cold out. And then that's almost certainly the purple mud dauber. Have you seen them? Are they purple or black and shining and kind of a purple tint? You there, Linda? Okay, well, I think that's probably the purple mud dauber. And they make a little mud nest with little holes in it. And they'll make them up in the above the window eaves and things like that. Use a wasp and hornet spray. That's what I've used in the past. Let's take a quick look at Shahoe. I'm almost out of time. Number 9 is Shahoe. Shahoe is caused by another fungus in peaches. I'll have to go to cover Shahoe next week. I want to thank everyone for watching the show and thank the group in the control room. And this is in Gardens, California. We'll see you next week. Thank you.